For section 1.5, we're going to study the method of pairwise comparisons. We already did head-to-head results when we were looking for the Condorcet candidate, and this is really the same idea, it's just that we're making it into a voting method. Since there isn't always a Condorcet candidate, we need another method to find the final winner with this particular method that we're using of pairwise comparisons. So here's what the method's going to be. We're still going to compare everybody in a head-to-head battle. So we're going to compare each pair of candidates just like we did in the pairwise comparison. And whoever gets the most votes within the pair is the winner. But instead of just finding out if there's one who wins above all others, in each individual match, the winner gets a point. So the winner in each pair gets a point. Gets 1 point. If there's a tie, then they each get half. Half a point. In the case of a tie, which does happen quite often, actually. And then we're going to repeat this with every pair of candidates, and the candidate with the most points wins. With the most points at the end, wins. Now, this does result in a tie oftentimes, or quite often, and so there's got to be some predetermined method, and this is on a case-by-case basis depending on what you're doing and for what. Or maybe you're allowed to let a tie stand if more than one person could be the winner, and that would be acceptable. So we'll have to determine ahead of time what the rules might be for a tie. But let's just try it without regard. We won't worry about the tie quite yet. Let's just try the method. So in example one, we're going to go back to the last section where we had the members of the Tasmania State University soccer team having an election choosing the captain. And we're going back to the original statement where we have 5 again in this last column. Remember in the last section we changed that to 3, but we're going to take that back to 5 again. And this time we're going to find the winner of the election using the method of pairwise comparisons. So what do we need to compare? Well, we need to compare A to B and candidate A to C, A to D, and we need to compare B to C, B to D, and lastly C to D. And you need to kind of think to yourself why we know we have enough comparisons here. Obviously, if we compare A to B, we don't need to also compare B to A. We're already doing that. We'll find the winner among the pairs. So we found all possible pairs. We're going to talk in a few minutes about how to count this number to make sure we have enough, but we'll leave that conversation for just a moment. For starters, let's go with the A to B. So when I'm looking at these, I'm looking at who wins over what. So in this first column, A wins over B, and the third column A wins over B, and in the fourth column A wins. So, oh, we forgot to tally up how many. So there's a total of 27 votes here. That can help us count sometimes. And right now we have 21 to 6. So 21 people prefer A to B. So 21 to 6. So that means A wins this pair, so A gets a point. So I'm just going to record my points over here. So A gets 1 point. Now let's look from A to C. A wins in the first column, the second column, and the fourth column. So that's a total of 5, 13, and there must be 14 remaining, and there is 13 to 14. Again, I'm just counting how many voters prefer A to C. These 4 prefer A to C, then here's another one, that's 5, and these 8. So altogether we have 13, and the other two columns make the additional 14. So C wins this head-to-head comparison and gets a point. I want you to pause a second here. I'd like you to pause the video if you can and figure out the rest of these 4 comparisons for yourself. And when you're done giving the points and deciding the winner, you can come back and check your work with what we've done here. All right, assuming that you've done that, let's keep going. So compare A to D. A wins these four, five, and eight, so another 13 to 4 to 14. So D wins that comparison and gets a point. Then B to C. B wins over C in these four, five, and that eight. So again, 13 to 14. Seeing that a lot. So C wins that head-to-head battle. We'll give C another point. B to D. B wins over D only in these first five votes. So we have five to the remaining 22. So D clearly wins that head-to-head battle and gets a point. And lastly, C to D. C wins over D in these nine and the last five. So a total of 14 to 13. So C wins that head-to-head battle. Okay, so we do have a winner. We have A with 1 point, C with 3 points, and D with 2 points. So C is our winner. Oops, too many N's. C is our winner using the method of pairwise comparisons. Now, if you recall the idea of a Condorcet candidate, we'll look back at this. C actually wins in all comparisons with everybody else. C wins over A, C wins over B, and C wins over D. So C is also our Condorcet candidate. Condorcet candidate. So it shouldn't be surprising that C is our winner by the method of pairwise comparisons. If there is a Condorcet candidate, then they will be the winner of the pairwise comparison. So this is a method that definitely does not violate the Condorcet criterion. It satisfies it. And in fact, we could show, although we're not going to here, that this method actually satisfies all three of the fairness criterion we've studied so far. And the other two were the majority criterion and the monotonicity criterion. And we're not going to show those right now, but it does satisfy all three of our criterion so far. So as promised, let's next discuss how many total points we might have in this system. So how many points are available in each pairwise comparison? Well, let's say that there's n total candidates. How many comparisons is n going to be in? So n's going to be compared to all the others. So how many is there? There's n minus 1 others. So all total, n's going to be in n times n minus, it's going to be in n minus 1 comparisons. If we count that up for all n, that's n times n minus 1 comparisons. So n minus 1 per candidate times n candidates total. However, this overcounts because if I compare A to B, that's one comparison. And this actually also counts B compared to A, and we don't want to double count. So we have to divide all of this by 2. So the total number of points is equal to n times n minus 1 over 2. And if we look at that previous one that we were doing, we had four candidates. So 4 times 3 over 2 was 12 over 2, which is 6. And we did indeed have 6 total comparisons, and 6 points were awarded. So as I already stated, this method satisfies all three of our current fairness criterion, but we have a fourth fairness criterion that this brings up and violates. And the fourth fairness criteria is called the independence of irrelevant alternatives criterion. And what this means is that if we have an alternative or a candidate which is irrelevant, it's a non-winner. If a non-winner pulls out of the race, it shouldn't change the winner of the race. If a non-winner pulls out of the race and we need to revote, a revote should not change the winner. We already know that this is violated in other points. We talked about the insincere voting. This would definitely be a case of that, of the of the person who's not likely to win pulling out and changing the ultimate winner of the race. And this particular method is susceptible to this fairness being violated. Let's take a look at an example where this occurs. So this example is problem 35 in your textbook. And in this problem, we have 26 members of the Tasmania State University chess team instead of the soccer team. We've got the chess team this time. They're holding an election to choose a captain as well. So we have 26 total votes for the 26 members, and they're given by this preference ballot here. Now let's go through the head-to-head comparison. We may not be able to fit all of them on here. First of all, let's count how many comparisons are we going to need. There are five candidates, so we're going to have 5 times 4 divided by 2. So it's 20 divided by 2, that's 10. So 10 comparisons to make. So I'm not going to write down all of the work, but I will write down all of the winners. So we have A compared to B, A to C, A to D. B gets compared to C. Oops, I forgot A to E. Whoopsies. Let me just go back. There we go. Fix that right up. A to E. And then we have B to C and D and E. Over here we'll write, let's see, what do we have left? C to D and E and D to E. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Good. I have all 10 of them now. And notice how I do that kind of in a really nice order so that I don't forget anybody along the way. That's purposeful. And that way I get everybody I need. Okay, again, I'm not going to write down all the numbers, but I will go through. I encourage you to pause, see if you can do it on your own, and then come back. But assuming that you did that, let's go on. So when I compare A to B, again, I'm assuming that you stopped and you took note of this, so I'm not going to go through how to count each one. You can always pause and check these out for yourself. But assuming that you do, when you compare A to B, I get 13 votes apiece. So this one's a tie. And so I award half a point to both A and B. When I do A to C, I get 8 to 18. So C wins and gets a point. A to D, I get 14 to 12. So A wins and gets a point. I'm just going to record the whole points below there. A to E gets me 21 to 5. A wins and gets a point. B to C is 8 to 18. C wins and gets a point. B to D is also 8 to 18. So D wins and gets a point. And B to E is also 8 to 18. There's only those 8 where B is more than all the rest. Or more than the C, D, and E. So E gets a point. C to D is 13 apiece, so it's a tie. So C gets a half point and D gets a half point. C to E is also a tie. So I have another half point. Oops, and this one goes to E, a half point. And in D to E we have 15 to 11. D wins and gets another whole point. So altogether, who wins? Well, we see that C has 3 total points. That's more than everybody else. So C wins. Now, let's see what happens when if A pulls out. So A decides not to run anymore and pulls out of the race. So essentially what's going on is that the first 4 comparisons no longer apply, and we're only looking at the rest. And if we look at those points values, I've written those up on another slide here, we can see that altogether we get 2 points for C, 2.5 for D, and 1.5 for E. That means D wins. So an irrelevant candidate, somebody, a non-winner pulls out of the race, and somebody different wins the race, D. D now wins. So this violates the irrelevant alternatives criterion. And that is the end of this section and the end of this chapter. We're not going to do the last section in this chapter.